A win is a win, a loss is a loss. There's absolutely no gray area, no in between. And I can't stand when gamblers or handicappers try to compensate. They try to come up with excuses for how they were on the right side of the game, but for one reason or another, it was a good loss. I'm sorry, if you're giving away or taking my money, it was a loss, and there's nothing good about it. Now, however, I will admit to you that some losses are definitely more painful than others. As far as I'm concerned, I like the mercy killing type of losses. Please, put me out of my misery early. That was not the case last night, however. As you know, last night I had another rare raise the bar 20 dime release, only the 27th ever in the 15 years since I created the sites. And they had been pretty much money in the bank, as you know as well. After cashing in with the most recent one, Middle Tennessee State on Thursday night, a 5-point favorite at home against Western Kentucky, an easy 18-point blowout win. I was 5-1 with these plays this season. So after winning also with Kentucky as a top-rated normal 15-dime play, an 18-point blowout win on Wednesday night over Ole Miss, I went and raised the bar again last night with the Penn Quakers. And if you saw the last 90 seconds of the game, Penn, I don't know if squandered would be the right word, but they did everything in their power to give away the cover. And ultimately, not only did they do that, but they gave away the game to Yale. And personally, they deserved to lose the game. That's how I felt, because once you gave away my cover, you deserve to lose the game. And tonight, I hope they lose the chance to be Ivy League champions as well. Yes, I am hell-bent on getting revenge against the Penn Quakers. But hey, it was a loss. And you know what? As I also like to say to you, I was not standing here turning cartwheels after Middle Tennessee State won on Thursday night, and I am not going to be sitting here crying in my Diet Coke this morning about the fact that I would be lamenting the loss on Penn, because I am still 5-2 on the season with those 20-dime plays. And I'll tell you what, guys. I had handicapped this Saturday card long before Penn took the floor last night. And there is a game that was simply screaming, bet me, bet me, bet me. And it was the Alabama at Texas A&M game that tips off at 2 o'clock. And I've still been winning. And I've had a nice little six-week run. I've had some bumps along the way the past couple of weeks. And I'm doing it again. I've got another 20-dime play today. And it's on the Texas A&M and Alabama contest, and it's once again the half price play of the day by using coupon code RAISE, because as Michael Douglas said in Wall Street, greed is good. And as long as I've got money in the pocket, I'm going right back to the well. The other big play today is Eric Schrader, who's going for winning day number 33 out of 53 and 18 out of 27 over the past 52 days. He's made $10 betters, a little over $11,000, fourth ever 200 dime play in college basketball since he's joined the site, and it's a late night tilt, San Diego State against Nevada. You get it for over half price off by using coupon code ERIC. He's on an 8-3 run with 100 dime releases. This play is twice as strong. You remember that big 200 dime play he also had in the NFL playoffs, that little game with the Jaguars upset in Pittsburgh. This play is just as strong. All your other discounts and coupon codes are over on the homepage. Let's get to your complimentary plays. Let's start with an interesting game in Big Five action in Philadelphia. City Series play. St. Joe's taking on LaSalle. Listen, the Hawks really, I think, shocked a hell of a lot of people, and yours truly, when they won last week at Rhode Island as a 13.5-point underdog. Rhode Island senior night. And I talked about Rhode Island yesterday on the video report, and they ended up in a very difficult game, losing at Davidson, and they entered the Atlantic 10 tournament now suddenly in a little bit of a tailspin, losing three of their final five games as the Atlantic 10 regular season champs. But on senior night, a couple of nights ago, they were laying 13.5 points, and St. Joe's, which was fighting for the number four seed and still are in earning the first round bye in the upcoming tournament, the Hawks go into Rhode Island, where the Rhode Island Rams had won, I think, 17 straight home games. They not only won, but they won by 30 points. They're on a 5-1 roll. They are hosting LaSalle today. Now, when the first time these two met February 3rd, it was a nip-and-tuck game, but St. Joe's had an early lead. They blew it. They ended up losing the game 81-78. Now, LaSalle is coming off a big home win, 71-53 over Dayton on Wednesday night. But keep in mind, this was a Dayton team that had lost six in a row on the road straight up and against the spread. One of the key players for LaSalle, one of their starting guards, Pookie Powell, did not play in that game against Dayton. He is questionable today. He averages 16.5 points, 4 rebounds, 4 assists a game. And in that first meeting with St. Joe's, 15 points, 11 assists, and 4 rebounds. So if he is not available or if he's not at 100%, that is definitely going to hurt the Explorers in this game. I'm going to go with St. Joe's in the revenge rematch here today because, listen, they blew a 5-point halftime advantage in the first game. They allowed LaSalle to close out that game on a 13-7 run. But the Hawks did out-rebound them 47-35. Problem is, they shot themselves in the foot. 13 turnovers. LaSalle only had 2. And LaSalle, one of their key players, may not be playing, may not be at 100%. And this line was 5.5. It's down to 4.5 as I do this video report at 10:15 Eastern Time this morning. All the more reason for me to go with St. Joe's in this contest. Your next complimentary play. Let's stay in the Atlantic 10. St. Bonaventure is a 2.5-point favorite at St. Louis. Now, St. Louis may be 6-1 straight up at home in conference play. The lone loss came to Rhode Island, but who have they beaten? George Washington, LaSalle, Fordham, Dayton, Duquesne, and Richmond. They're all the second echelon, lower tier teams in that conference. Or in the case of where I will give you that at times Richmond has played well and at times LaSalle has played well, when they played those teams, they weren't playing well. You've got a St. Bonaventure team that I think the best thing that St. Bonaventure has going for it is an extra day off. And what I'm referring to is that St. Bonaventure, who I talked about yesterday when I was giving you the preview of the Davidson-Rhode Island game, St. Bonaventure is coming off one of the best college games that I saw all season, and that was the Tuesday night triple overtime 117-113 win at home that extended their winning streak to 11 in a row over Davidson, a game that took 3 hours and like 19 minutes to complete. What a hell of a game. Unlike Rhode Island, who was handicapped by having to play last night on a Friday on the road, St. Bonaventure had an extra day to rest, to recover, to recuperate, and get that game a little more water under the bridge, shall we say. Now, they're only a 2.5-point favorite. The first time these two met, they won 79-56 at home on February 7th. They shot 46.6%. They were led by one of their senior guards, Jalen Adams, who had a career-high 44 points and hit 10 three-pointers. Their defense was outstanding, and that is their calling card, as they forced 16 turnovers in that game. Again, they won that game by 23 points. And St. Louis, since then, has suspended one of their starting guards for the rest of the season, Jordan Goodwin, who was averaging 11 points, 4 assists, and 7.5 rebounds. He had 11 points and 9 rebounds and 3 assists in the first meeting. I think a lot of people look at this price and go, oh, this could be a potential trap game because, again, you have a St. Bonaventure team coming off that triple overtime game. Is it a meaningful game for them? No, they're locked into the number 2 position in the Atlantic 10 Conference. But with that tournament coming up and with Rhode Island suddenly on a slippery slope, you know, St. Bonaventure has something else to play for. If you look at Joe Lenardi's bracketologist, the guy who really is just a genius when it comes to projecting teams and their big dance projections in terms of their seedings, right now St. Bonnie is right there at like a 9 seed in the big dance. They want to firm that up, and who knows what could happen if they lose this game. So I think they have added motivation. One, you want to go into the Atlantic 10 tournament with a 12-game winning streak. And two, you want to firm up your postseason aspiration in your bracket seed. So 2.5 points, the way I look at it, is a very cheap price for a far superior team. And I don't care that the Billikens have won 6 out of 7 home conference games this season. Your other complimentary play today, Middle Tennessee State. Listen, I just used them on Thursday night. Now, they wrapped up their second straight regular season Conference USA crown. Is this game against Marshall important to them in terms of their conference seeding? No. For the upcoming tournament? Absolutely not. But let's look at the other forms of motivation. This is a Middle Tennessee State team that has won 11 in a row and has just one conference loss this year. When did that winning streak date back to? A January 18th loss by 10 points in Huntington, West Virginia to the Thundering Herd. It's senior night. It's a Middle Tennessee State team that has just been money in the bank for me so much this season. This is a Middle Tennessee State team that has won every single one of its home conference games but one by a double-digit margin. It is a Marshall team that is so-so on the road. It doesn't play much defense. You've got a Middle Tennessee State team that is one of the top 30 teams in the country in terms of scoring defense. It allows only about 63.5 points a game. Hell, look at what they just did to a Western Kentucky team that entered that game on Thursday night. And again, I had a 20-dime play on the Blue Raiders in that contest. Western Kentucky came into that game with a 6-game winning streak. In the last 5 games, they had shot over 55%. They held Western Kentucky to 64 points, right there on their season average in terms of their defensive yield, and held the Hilltoppers to 44.4% shooting in that contest. And again, this is a revenge game. How did Marshall prep for this game? They got hammered at UAB 91-77. Those are the same UAB Blazers that last Saturday, Middle Tennessee State beat 79-54 at home in a game in which the Blue Raiders starting point guard did not play because he was suffering from the ill effects of a concussion. Number 28 scoring defense, again, giving up an average of 65.3 points a game, 11-1 at home this season. I got to lay the points with Middle Tennessee State. So if I had to rank the three selections, I like St. Bonaventure number one. I would then go with Middle Tennessee State number two. And then the, that's how I would do it. They would be the top two plays. And then the other selection would be ranked number three, St. Joe's number three. That'll do it for your Saturday card. I wish you well, guys, and I'll talk to you again on Sunday when we do it again.